Max introduced me earlier, but I'm Bill Saverin. I'm the CSEP software developer at SKEC. Max did a pretty nice job of giving an overview of all the stuff we've been working on CSEP. So in this talk, I'm going to go into kind of a few more details and try to set the stage and the picture for the context of what CSEP was doing in the past, and then go into a lot of the reasons about why we made some of the changes, how we're modernizing the CSEP experiments. And I'm going to finish my talk off with some, you know, slides just showing highlights from the last 2 years of CSEP activities. I would also like to echo Max's comments about sort of looking at our old presentations from 2019 and looking how there was like a lot of wants and promises. So it was really fun to make this presentation and see sort of everything come together that we've been talking about wanting to do over the last couple of years. So really just for everyone that's not that familiar with CSEP, I'm going to give a little primer about CSEP on this slide. So really CSEP is kind of an independent third party that's comprised of international scientists that are interested in advancing earthquake predictability research through the prospective testing of earthquake forecasts. And the key really here is the prospective testing. CSEP does this by organizing community-led experiments that started off with Realm, and there have been several in the several that followed along, looking at different types of forecasts, different regions, different assumptions. CSEP really accomplished this by providing the cyber infrastructure, which were known as testing centers. And these were designed to eliminate potential biases that might arise if you're evaluating your own model or coming up with your own null hypothesis to look at how well your own forecasting model is doing. It was really done because there's kind of a problem if you have a whole bunch of people that are developing earthquake forecasting models. Sometimes they're not comparable. The forecasts might be issued over slightly different regions for slightly different time periods, make slightly different assumptions about the data that are being input into them or being used for the evaluations. So CSEP really has tried to standardize this whole process and really allow earthquake forecasting models to be evaluated and compared against one another. So the CSEP testing center is kind of an important part because it's really the sort of crux of what CSEP provides to the community in terms of an actual product. And really the CSEP testing centers, as Max said, are basically Linux servers that have Python codes that are installed on them that are able to schedule and autonomously run forecast evaluations, forecasts in their evaluations. And they were originally developed around the time of the Realm project, and they were sort of designed with these guiding principles in mind. So there's four of them here. There's the concept of transparency. And really what this means is that all the data and artifacts and everything that is needed or part of the experiment lives on the testing center. So in theory, anyone could have access to this data because it all exists on, you know, the testing center server. The testing centers provide a controlled environment, which sort of prevents a modeler from, let's say, you know, making a small tweak to their modeling code after they found out that their model is insufficient to describe some certain data or a new aftershock sequence comes. And that makes the models really comparable over a long time period that you need to evaluate models probabilistically. They should be able to provide reproducibility for the results. So let's say there's a bug or something happens and you want to rerun a new evaluation or a new experiment. They should be able to do that. And it's able to be done because all the data lives on the testing centers. And finally, the testing center should facilitate comparability. Basically, this point that I was just making about how there needs to be sort of standard definitions for, you know, regions and times and everything that you need to make two models actually directly comparable against one another. And I think the main concept that I want to make on this slide is that in the testing center, there would be several different experiments that could be running in a single testing center. So for example, in California, you know, here's a list of five. I think there might be more, but here's the five main experiments that I remember. They cover all different regions geologically. There's different time periods, different catalog parameters and all of this. And so really, if you think about kind of the way that things are split up, really the testing center is like kind of what provides the controlled environment here. That's important to eliminate some of these biases. And I'll come back to this when I talk about how we're modernizing CSEP experiments, but let's just keep this in mind about how like everything is pretty tightly coupled together between the testing center and all the experiments. So Max mentioned the Realm experiment. I'm not gonna spend a lot of time on this because I think everybody's heard of it, but this is really just the experiment that kicked off sort of this idea of community or this community experiment idea. it really arose after some decisions that were made to, you know, properly analyze all seismic hazard forecasts. And in Realm, there was 15 different time independent forecasts that were considered for California. It's really kicked off the whole concept of evaluating probabilistic forecasts with the CSET testing we're using and the concepts for the testing center that I just presented on the last slide. There's been a ton of papers about Realm. So if you're not familiar, check out the SRL special issue from 2007. There's just a lot of information about Realm. So after Realm, I think the Realm project was a great success and it spurred a lot of international CSET developments. So it started from a single testing center in California. And you can see all these little blue circles here are new testing centers. Max mentioned those in his talk, but towards the end of the first phase of CSET, there were over 450 models installed in these testing centers internationally, which is quite impressive. And they comprised a ton of different testing regions. And I think these efforts resulted in almost 100 publications over the first decade of CSEP. And really a lot of these achievements were outlined in the 2018 SRL special issue. So I'd point you to that. There's some really good summary papers by Daniel Schorlemmer and Andy Michael and Max and others talking about sort of the achievements from this phase of CSEP. So just to sort of wrap up this first phase in the background, so the status of the CSEP testing centers. So in 2018, basically the CSEP testing centers went into an on-demand mode. And what I mean by this is that the servers are still online and accessible so we can access the data. We could even rerun new forecasts if we want, but they're not regularly processing any new forecasts and evaluations. The servers are online, but not operational. There were a few challenges that made maintaining these and extending them difficult to accommodate sort of the new types of forecasts that we want to look at. I think the first and main one is that the system architecture was tightly coupled to the testing routines and the underlying file system, which meant that it was very difficult for you to go into the testing center and use any of the routines in your own research. So this resulted in basically every researcher doing CSEP work would have to re-implement the CSEP test themselves, which is a challenge from a programming standpoint because vetting the codes and making sure that people have the same methods that they're using and publishing results is a little challenging. They also required a non-trivial server administration to keep operational. So, you know, we had a dedicated system administrator at USC that ran the several testing centers, and this was the case in all the other ones. And a lot of times, if there was any turnover with sort of staff, it was really difficult to like maintain operations and update the testing centers. And finally, the last challenge here is that there's really a single point of contact for any of the data and software development. So there was really no public forum in which you could go and collect data from any of the testing centers. And also all of the code was very much well owned and maintained by a single developer. And so, you know, if that person leaves or when that person left, it became difficult to maintain this code base. So kind of as a result of all of that and a lot of things that we learned, both, you know, both strong successes and some challenges, we've modernized CSEP experiments. And this really involves sort of two main approaches. And the whole point here is to really decouple the testing center server architecture from the actual software and everything that runs the experiment and does the implementations. So the first step is this community-based software development that Max talked a little bit about, and I'm going to get into a little bit more on the next couple of slides. So we moved from this community-based software development to from a single developer model. And the single developer model is kind of traditionally what's been done in academia for a long time. But there's a lot of really great software that's been developed in a community-based environment. Probably anyone that uses Linux is the best example of this type of software development. So it's pretty vetted as far as things go. And then the next one is the open earthquake experiment format. So instead of having a centralized testing center, the open forecasting experiments basically decentralize the experiment format and enable a lot more access to all of the different aspects and artifacts from the experiment. And I'll go into some more detail about these on the next slide. So really the big benefits of this community development approach is it basically allows us to leverage the entire community that's interested in doing this work. So a lot of times people are already developing code and software on their own for their own research. And in this approach, it sort of allows us to take advantage of all of that and use contributions that people might have written for a paper, and then those can then be shared back with the community. So we've already seen a lot of great success with this in PyCCEP, and I'll talk about this in a second, but this is a really big thing. So instead of having one person develop it, now you sort of move to a software maintainer that makes sure that the software is developed in a way that's upholding best practices, but then anyone can go in and implement a new testing method or a new plotting method or any sort of new method that they think would be beneficial to the community. This really presents this single point of failure problem where there's only like sort of one owner of the code base and one person that really knows it. So anybody that contributes to the code base is going to be familiar with that part of the code base. So it really gets like sort of a robust understanding of the code. And everything is done in an open source approach, meaning that any modifications, all the code, everything is done in public. Any of the discussions about the code are done in a public forum. So everything is very visible and transparent. And we've sort of showcased this method by developing PyCCEP, which has, you know, contributions from several groups around the world. I think we have 10 different developers that have contributed to PyCCEP, you know, in various forms of contributions from small tests, or I mean, small plots to bug fixes, to, you know, huge new testing features and new modeling features. I think I pushed the wrong button. There we go. So we're kind of at SCEC maintaining PyCCEP and leading the development, but it's really a community effort. So just some small background or information about PyCCEP. So PyCCEP really provides like all of what you'd call in computer talk is like the business logic. So this is really like all the science code that you would use to evaluate a forecast. It gives you ways of representing forecasts, ways of plotting forecasts, ways of specifying spatial regions, different types of evaluation methods, different ways of specifying catalogs and working with catalogs. And really all these tools come together to help us evaluate earthquake forecasting models. This image here sort of shows like the main modules of PyCCEP and how they fit together. There's specific ways of representing USERF through ETOS forecasts. So it's really, you know, quite easy to load in a USERF through ETOS forecast and play around with all the data in there, like you're working with MATLAB arrays or NumPy arrays. Plotting them up is really easy. And I'll show some specific examples in the highlight section of kind of some publications that we've gotten out of using PyCCEP. A big part of this is maintaining and trying to grow the PyCCEP developer community. So that involves a little bit more work than just developing the code. Basically, you know, in order to do that, we've hosted training workshops to teach grad students and postdocs about how to actually do community software development. It involves learning tools like GitHub and working in shared GitHub repositories, which isn't necessarily always taught in, you know, like graduate level computer programming or anything. So far, we've gotten 18 forks and 27 stars on GitHub, which, you know, is pretty decent in that short amount of time. And we've gotten actual like merge contributions and releases from 10 different developers in various institutions. And this figure is sort of showing the PyCCEP developer community that showed up for our PyCCEP training workshop. So let's see, let's go next. So we've published PyCCEP in two places. These journals, even though the titles are the same, these journals are really fundamentally different. So the Journal of Open Source Software really has a very short form paper that's really just a couple of paragraphs. And then it involves a more thorough code review where the reviewers check out the code, try the tests, make sure that everything works right, it's easy to install. And then we publish it in ESRL, which contains a lot more information about the code, the theory behind it, everything that's going on. I think it's noteworthy that this code basically follows like the target best practices for CIG. So really it's like meeting the bar for best practices that you can have for an open source software development code. There's very well documented, like the code's well documented and the theory's well explained. So if you're curious about looking at it, go to this website. And you know, within the last couple of years of releasing PyCCEP, it's already been used in, you know, several publications. So I think that's evidence that this approach is catching on and working well. So that kind of sums up this whole community development idea, what we've done with it and how we've applied it. to PyCSEP. So the next part is this open experiment format. So this is really based on the idea of a reproducibility package, which was put together by some USC researchers and others. Her name is Victoria Stodden, sort of worked on this idea. And really what it is it's the idea that you package all the artifacts that you need to reproduce computational results and write the code in a way that you basically have light switch reproducibility, they call it. So you basically just run a single command and it'll reproduce every figure from the paper. Like the code's there, everything's on Zenodo. So it makes it very easy to just, you know, take a paper and just reproduce all the results from it right away. Which is really powerful if you're trying to actually like extend work that people have done or try to understand what's going on. So the big difference here is that on the first slide, when I was talking about the testing centers, really the sort of like compartmentalization of the testing center happened at the testing center level. And now what we've done is decoupled the hardware from this process and we're doing all of the compartmentalization at the experiment level. And so the big advantage of this is now, let's say, for example, someone wanted to reproduce the realm results, they could obtain, you know, if we had a realm floating experiment, they could, 5 minutes. Okay, so I need to go quicker. So basically the main takeaway here is that, so the floating experiment sort of containerizes or compartmentalizes this experiment. Yeah, there's a lot of advantages that we can talk about. I'm going to skip over the guiding principles, but the main takeaway here is that this approach actually lets us achieve all of these things much better than the actual testing centers. Everything's totally transparent. Everything's would be on Zenodo with DOIs issued. So there's no question of like what the actual data is that you're getting and what was used in publications. Forecasts are minted with DOIs. So anytime you'd evaluate them, it's automatically sort of prospective in that sense. Obviously reproducible because that's the way that they're made. And then, you know, the comparability comes from just the way that the experiment is set up. This figure kind of shows how the experiment works. So we have an example of this. There's the global earthquake forecasting experiment. If you're curious, get this presentation and go to Zenodo. You can check it out and you should be able to run it with a single command on your computer and reproduce all the results from the experiment that we have here. And so I'm just going to go quickly through some highlights. I kind of put these in chronological order so you can see the way that PyCSEP's evolved in terms of its capabilities over time. So this is sort of the first real publication from PyCSEP, and this was an evaluation that we did of USER3ETOS after Ridgecrest. These plots basically are able to be made with, I don't know, like, you know, a handful of lines of code to read into USER3ETOS forecast, compute the background rates how you want, and then plot them up this way. So it's pretty easy to work with these really large data files. It could be on the, you know, on over 40 gigabytes. And we've also added some new catalog-based testing methods that relax the Poisson assumption and allow us to better properly handle the probability distributions provided by the forecast. The next real paper that came out of PyCSEP was a global forecast evaluation that was done by Biona and others, where he developed two new global forecasts, and these were, you know, all plotted and evaluated using PyCSEP. You probably, if you're familiar with CSEP, you remember these sort of like standard looking CSEP plots. These are all, you know, very easy to calculate using PyCSEP as well. So here's some really interesting work coming out of Varner Mazzocchi's group done by postdoc Marcus Herman. He's looking at building ensemble models using score model averaging and also ontological ensembles of forecasts. So this is a really nice way of taking a collection of forecasts and building ontological distributions around them to really sort of test our knowledge about earthquake forecasting as opposed to a single forecast. Some new interesting work coming out of GFC is sort of addressing the problem for global forecasts where there's something like 6.5 million spatial cells, but only a small fraction of those actually see earthquakes. So we've been working on developing some multi-resolution data-driven grids using quad trees where you can sort of see this grid has more refinement in areas where there are tests. So the idea here is that you know, it drastically improves computational performance because there's much less numbers to crunch when you're evaluating the forecast and also potentially improves the power of the tests So this is sort of the point of the global earthquake forecasting experiment that I just mentioned on the last slide. This is a really nice paper from Bayona and others again, where he evaluated California hybrids and he introduced a new type of CSEP score, which is using a binary score. And I should mention that in all of these new contributions, these authors were the ones that actually contributed the code to PI-CSEP. So Tonio Bayona, who did this work, implemented the binary scores himself. I was just there to, you know, make sure everything fit in the context of PI-CSEP, but he did, you know, all of the heavy lifting. And same with Asim, who did the quad tree stuff. He implemented all of that himself in PI-CSEP. And this figure is just showing some number test results where you're looking at Poisson distributions and the binary scores. And finally, I don't want to take all of Tonio's thunder, so I'm just going to show this quickly, but this is his work on global and regional evaluation. So comparing gear one versus like regionally calibrated forecasting models, all these plots he made with PI-CSEP. So I think that might be the last one I have, but I think, you know, just seeing this and seeing how people who are, you know, not professional software developers can easily get in and add, like, make serious contributions to this package, I think really, you know, helps me realize the power of doing this type of work. And I think this is a really good way to keep moving things forward as far as, you know, CSEP and even software development, like on a more academic level goes. So yeah, that's all I've got. So I have some time for a couple questions.